Welcome back and good afternoon once again. In the earlier session, we had seen an important concept called as the state diagrams. So in that particular state diagrams, the basic purpose of drawing the state diagram is to incorporate the behavioral element in the UML diagramming. So let us see once again a very good concept wherein which we can interact one object with the another object. So in this session, we will go through the working with the sequence diagrams. So the state diagrams you had learned in the previous session, we are talking about only a single object. Like we had taken one example called as the GUI, graphical user interface, and we had seen three states called as the initializing state, the working state, and the shutdown state. So for an object, we had seen, so whenever there are certain state changes, then we are taking care with by drawing a diagram called as the state diagram. Suppose if there are there may be several objects in a system wherein which one object may be interacting with the other object or objects. So how to take care of this particular concept in the UML diagramming? There is a component called as, or as there is a technique called as sequential diagramming. So this particular sequential diagram is nothing but it depicts the condition called as the object interactivity. Like suppose if one object wants to communicate something to the other object, or else one object after fulfilling one condition, it is passing on the information to the other object in the form of a message. So how to go about it? So the important aspect in this particular category is the time dimension. So with respect to the time, one object is interacting with the other object. And once again, how much time the object is activated during its execution. So that particular thing also we have to take care. So here, the time is the main thing that is playing the prominent role. So let us see the introductory part. The state diagram we have learned in the previous session shows the changes an object that goes through. The UML enables you to expand your field of view and show how an object interacts with the other objects. In this expanded view, you will include an important dimension called as the time. So whenever an object interacts with the other object, so how much time it is interacting and what is the duration of the activation phase? So that particular thing also we have to keep track. So in this particular sequential diagramming technique, we will take care of the issue. So the key idea is that interactions among objects takes place in a specified sequence, and the sequence takes time to go from beginning to the end. So these are the two aspects you have to see. When you create a system, you specify the sequence and you use the UML diagram to do it. So let us see the definition of a sequence diagram. A class diagram is a static view, whereas the sequence diagram provides a dynamic view. So the sequence diagram is useful for modeling the scenarios of a use case. The sequence diagram consists of objects represented in the usual way, messages represented as solid line, and then the time represented as a vertical progression. So these are the conventions that we are following. In the sequence diagram, we take various objects that are involved in the system plus the time dimension, and that too, what is the duration of the time and what are the messages that needs to be sent from one object to the other objects. So these are the things that we need to take care. In order to depict the object, we have a notation. We will be keeping an object in the rectangle box by naming the object. Suppose if you don't have any name, we will be keeping them as an anonymous object. Then we have to give the lifeline. Lifeline is nothing but the total lifetime of the object. So when it is been activated or when it is been initiated and what is the end time. So that particular thing we have to take care. And then the other part, the main part is the message. So these particular messages are represented as solid line arrows. So there are two kinds of messages that we'll be talking them in the later stage. So that particular messages also we can depict in the sequence diagram. And the time is represented as a vertical progression. So from the object, we will be placing some dotted line where in which it will be displaying, it will be representing a kind of progression that is taking place during that particular time. So let us see here, the important component in the sequence diagram is the objects. So the objects are laid out near the top of the diagram from left to right. So from left to right, we will be placing the objects that are there in the system. So that particular object's placement may be in any way, like from the simplified to the complex kind, or else anything can be possible. There may not be any sequence to be followed, but we have to see the kind of logic of involvement and other things. The extended downward from each object is a dashed line called the object's lifeline. So this is the thing I am talking about. So this gives the dimension of the time. So this is the time where in which this particular object is live or else have the life. So this particular dashed line gives the object's lifetime or else lifeline. Along the lifeline, we will be representing a narrow rectangles called as the activation rectangles. So these particular activations represent an execution of an operation the object carries out. So during this particular thing, suppose there may be the start point of the narrow rectangle is nothing but the start point of the execution of an operation. So the duration or else the length of the rectangle represents the length of the duration. Let us see one simple example over here. So this is representation of a sequence diagram. Here in the rectangle, I am mentioning the object name. So if at all I am not giving any name, means it is nothing but an anonymous object. So that particular object I am giving over here in the rectangle. This particular object I will be placing on the top part, like top part of the diagram. So this particular object, and then from this particular object, I am giving one line called as the dotted line, wherein which it is mentioning about the lifetime or else lifeline of the object. So until and like suppose if this particular lifeline is carried out for a long time, that is nothing but this particular object is live for that particular duration of time. Then there is another component which is very important called as the activation of the object. So this is the start of the activation of an operation for that particular object, and then this is the end. Like this is the end. This is the end of the activation of the object. So this particular narrow rectangle indicates the activation time. Suppose there may be another occurrence of the same object after a span of some time. So that particular thing also we can express. So we'll be giving that particular dotted arrow, and whenever once again that particular object is activated, then we can start that particular object with a narrow rectangle, and for the duration we have to lengthen that particular rectangle, narrow rectangle, and after the duration or else after the end point, after the end of the activation is over, we have to end the rectangle. So these are the common conventions you have to remember while drawing the sequence diagram. So the next aspect after the objects aspect is the messages. How to pass the messages? Where to represent the messages on the sequence diagram? A message that goes from one object to another goes from one object's lifeline. So this is the basic thing you have to remember. One's lifeline to the other's object's lifeline. So from that particular lifeline, you have to pass on the arrow to the other object's lifeline. So, and then you can place the message upon the arrow. So that is how you have to give the message upon the arrow line. So there are two types of messages you can give. One is the synchronous message and the other is the asynchronous message. In the synchronous message, we can call it as a type of message called as a call. This is nothing but this is a request from the object sending the message to the object receiving the message. We are just sending one request. This is the request. This is the request to be sent from object 1 to the object 2. And then that request is for the receiver to carry out the carry out one of its operations. Suppose if several operations, several options of operations are available, in order to carry out one of the operations that are available by the object, we are just sending a request to that object. Usually, this entails the sender waiting for the receiver to carry out that operation. Because the sender waits for the receiver, this message also referred to as synchronous. Until and unless the message is received from object 1, the object 2 doesn't perform any action. After the receiver receiving the information from object 1, then depending upon the choice or else depending upon the option that is made from the object 1, it performs the respective operation. So this particular sync technique is there. So this is called as a synchronous message, or else you can call this one as a call. And there is another kind of message passing called as the asynchronous, which we will be talking it in a later stage. The symbol, the convention that we have to follow whenever we are sending some synchronous message is a solid line with the arrow. So this particular, at this particular end, the lifeline of the object 1 will be there, and at the arrow's head, like this particular portion, the lifeline of the object 2, which is the receiver, will be there. And then whenever we are playing a kind of sync technique, so suppose if I am, suppose object 1 is sending some message to object 2, and depending upon that particular message, it is acted upon, or else it is playing the operation, then it also can send, this particular receiver also can send a message kind of thing to the message 1, like just like an acknowledgement. That particular acknowledgement, we can keep track by using a dotted line from the receiver side to the starter side, or else the activator side. So that particular arrow should not be a solid arrow, because solid arrow represents the synchronous kind of message. So we have to place a kind of dotted arrow with the arrowhead towards the sender side. So here, look, there is a difference between the arrowheads also. Here this is a solid arrowhead, and here we are just giving a stroke arrowhead. So there is a kind of difference. Acknowledgement, we are just placing a single tool, like a pointed lines of arrowhead, and here it is a solid line. And then let us see the asynchronous kind of message. With this one, the sender transfers control to the receiver and does not wait for the operations to complete. So here also we are giving the convention called as a solid line, but look here, there is a change in the arrowhead position, or else arrowhead. This is not solid, but this is just a combination of two lines. This is just a this is a simple thing, just like in the case of a acknowledgement. So this, in this particular asynchronous kind, the sender transfers the control. This is not giving any request. This is not sending any request. This is just transferring the control to the receiver, and receiver is taking care of the rest of the thing. This is not the case just like the synchronous. In the synchronous message, the receiver is acting upon the message received by it from the sender. But in the asynchronous mode, asynchronous transfer or asynchronous message, it is not waiting for the message to receive or request to receive, and it is not acted upon directly, the request that it has made. This is just passing the control, and it is taking over, and it is acting upon its own operation. So the next concept that we have to learn is the time concept. How to represent the time on the sequence diagram? The diagram represents time in the vertical direction. Time starts at the top and progresses towards the bottom. The object starts from the left and it is progressing towards the right, but the time starts from each and every object's right from the top and it is progressing towards the bottom. The message that's closer to the top occurs earlier in time than a message that is closer to the bottom. This particular aspect is very important while drawing the sequence diagram. And this particular, whenever we are providing the dimension of the time, then there is a kind of y-axis also. That is the time dimension also we are taking care. So this is a kind of two-dimensional figure. On one dimension, we are taking care of the messages that are transmitted from object to the object, to the other object, from left side to the right side. And the other aspects we are taking care is the time aspects, from top to the bottom. So this particular sequential diagram is a two-dimensional diagramming technique. The left to right dimension is the layout of the objects, and top to bottom dimension shows the passage of the time or delay of the time. So let us see one example and understand the concept. Here I am placing two objects and I am not naming the objects. So these are nothing but the anonymous objects. And first object is named with name 1 and the other object is named with the object. So object is nothing but it is the instance of a class. So here there is a lifeline I had drawn right from the object, and this particular lifeline is nothing but this is showing the lifetime of the object. So here this rectangle, narrow rectangle is nothing but in this particular period of time, or else the activation is there for this object, and during this particular period of time activation of name 2 is, or the next object is there. And then I had showed the solid arrow, so it means that I am sending an synchronous message to the second object. And then from this side also there is a solid thing, a solid arrow that it is depicting that name 2, that is the object 2, is sending a synchronous message to name 1. And once again there may be some sort of message given from object to itself also, like a check condition kind of thing, where in which I had given it in a cyclic fashion over here, where in which the object itself is giving some sort of message to itself. So this particular thing also we can mention. So this is a simple kind of example where in which two objects are exchanging the messages. Then let us see a simple example where in which a car burner is there, that is one object, a car key is there, that is the other object, and a car itself is there, that is the third object. Let us see how this particular message transfers are being done and how the things are happening over here. In order to go, represent this particular sequence diagram, let us draw the static view of the complete picture. In this particular static view, I am taking three classes. One is the car owner's class, the second is the car key class, and third is the car class. So in the car owner class, there are four attributes. One is the name attribute, the other is date of birth of the car owner, address, and then the license number. These are the four attributes of the car owner. And then there are two operations, that is the drive operation, the park operation, and there are two other things called as the signal things, wherein which it comes under the asynchronous messages symbol, the blink lights and the beep. I am putting it as the operations under the car owner class. And then there is another class I am taking here, car key. And then for every car key there will be some sort of identification number. That particular identification number I am taking it as one of the attributes as key ID number. And then the operation on that particular car key is nothing but there are several buttons placed on them, and by pressing each and every button it performs the respective operations. So depending upon the button name, here I am putting one condition over here, B colon button name. Depending upon the button I am selecting, the corresponding operations will be done. And then car itself. So in this particular car I am mentioning four attributes. One is make, model, year, and then the tag number, or else the engine number. So depending upon the key that is pressed over there, the particular operations will be done, like lock operation, unlock operations, or else the open trunk, or open and open the dicky. So that particular operations can also be performed. So I am taking only three operations, lock, unlock, or else the open the trunk operation. So here there is an interface I had provided. So pressing upon the button pad, button on the button pad, corresponding functions needs to be done. So there is a kind of interface between the car owner who is holding the key and the car key. So the car key is held by the car owner. Depending upon the button pressed by the car owner, that particular operation is being performed. So I am giving one sort of a physical interface between the car owner and the car key, and a wireless connection between the car key and the car. So whenever the user, car owner, is pressing the button, corresponding operation is being done, but that particular car key is not physically connected to the car. So that's why I am giving here the interface as the wireless connection. So without any wire this particular operation is being done. That's why I had quoted this particular operation as a wireless operation, this interface as a wireless interface. And then here I had, there are some two classes like the aggregation of the things, like signal, blink lights, and then the beep. Whenever I am locking the car, suppose if I am pressing the key for lock, to lock the car, then whenever I am pressing that particular button, it obviously blinks all the lights, the four indicator lights, and then it will give one beep sound and the car automatically gets locked. So this is the basic static view of the case study. Then let us transform this particular case study to the sequence diagram. So this is the beginning of the sequence diagram. Here I had selected three objects: the car owner object, car key object, and then car object. So here I am not mentioning any name that indicates that this particular objects I have selected are the anonymous objects. And here I am from each and every object I am deriving the lifeline. So these three are the lifelines. Let us look into the actual sequence diagram. So the messages complete the sequence diagram. Look here the car owner is there, and then the get button press is the message that is being passed on to the car key. Depending upon the button, the corresponding action needs to be taking place. So here car owner, he doesn't have anything to be executed, any operation needs to be executed. He just presses the button, or else he will be listening to the messages that are being transformed by the car or car key. So those are the things he will be doing. So there is nothing like the complete execution of the operation from the car owner. He has just pressed the button. Later on in the car key, look here, there is a narrow rectangle I had given over here. So depending upon the get button press, depending upon the option here selected, the car processes the key, and then it will see. Suppose if the button pressed by him is a lock key. Here in this particular case, the message is from car to the car itself. It is just checking the condition. That particular if condition is being checked by keeping the message in the square brackets. So B is equal to lock. Suppose if the item, else if the button pressed by the car owner is a lock button. So that is nothing but if it is getting checked over here. So that particular check condition is to be put it within the square brackets. So then if that is true, then the lock operation needs to be executed. And then what it should give? It should blink the lights once, the indicators once, and it also should give the beep. So these particular solid arrows are nothing but they are conveying the message to the car owner. So this can be viewed by the car owner. The sound can be heard and the lights can be viewed. So these particular messages are being received by the car owner. And these particular things are asynchronous kind of things. The car is not giving any sync to the car owner, but it is giving a kind of async message. So here also you can see the duration of that particular action performance of the car key is till here, then from here to here, and then after process key message is been transferred from car key to car, then the actual action of the car is taking place. So I had shown the duration of this particular activity from this particular point to this particular point until a beep sound is completed. So in this way we can draw the diagram of the sequence diagram of the case study. So this is one way. We have some sort of background, then we are transferring that particular background or some sort of situation to a class diagram, and then that particular class, from that particular class diagram I am trying to derive the sequence diagram. This is one context. Suppose in the second context I can use the sequence diagram in the second context also. Like earlier we had seen the use cases. So in the use cases are nothing but the cases that have been derived from the user's inputs. So from that particular use cases are nothing but they are the group of scenarios. So from that particular use cases also I can take upon the use case, a scenario in the use case, and I can derive a sequence diagram. Let us examine another example. This is the second context. We are taking the scenario of one of the use case and we are drawing a sequence diagram. So let us take the simple example that we are talking from the earlier classes onwards, that is the soda machine. The class diagram will model the entities that make up a soda machine To keep it simple, assume that there are three components. A front component of the soda machine, a vending machine is there, a register component is there, and a dispenser component is available. So in the front component, the functionalities that are, the operations that are included are, it accepts the selections. Like suppose if there are several options, like four to five kinds of soda brands available in that particular vending machine, depending upon the choice, it should vend the can. So accept selections and case, displays prompts like out of stock or use correct change, receives change from the register and makes it available to the customer. Suppose if the cost of the soda is 5 rupees and if the user is putting 10 rupees, then it should send back some 5 rupees in the form of the change. So it should return the cash also along with the can. So these are the front component operations that should be performed, and the register should perform the gets the customer's input from the front panel, updates its cash reserve, and then checks for the change. Suppose if the customer gave a 10 rupees note instead of 5, then it should also send the change. The dispenser checks the availability of a selection, releases a can of a soda. So this is a kind of use case that we have derived for the vending machine. These are the three basic components. These are the three objects that I can take. So this is the basic class diagram. Here there are soda machine is nothing but it is an aggregation of three components. One is the front component, second is the register component, and then the dispenser component. And I had listed the operations of the front component, the register component, and the dispenser component. So here soda machine, I am putting it here as a single solid diamond. This is nothing but these three components are making the complete machine. So these three components contributes to the machine. So here there is a kind of aggregation relationship that needs to be shown using the solid diamond with a connection, solid arrows, solid lines connection. So this is the use case I am taking. The customer inserts the correct change and the customer selection is available. So this is the best case I am taking, and for this particular best case I have to draw the sequence diagram. So what are the sequence of steps that are going to be for this particular best case? The customer inserts the money into the money slot in the front of the machine and makes a selection. He puts the money, he makes the selection. The money travels to the register, which updates itself. Because of this, as this is the best case scenario, an availability check reveals the soda in the stock and the register has the dispenser release the soda to the front of the machine. So these are the actual steps needs to be performed in this particular best case scenario. So we want to try to transform this particular best case scenario into the sequence diagram. So for this particular thing, I have taken the objects as the customer as one of the objects who is activating the actual transaction, then the front panel, register, and then the dispenser. So here the front panel is accepting the cash and the selection from the customer. So here a solid arrow like a sink is there because I have to accept, and that particular depending upon the cash, depending upon the selection he has given, I have to vend the can to him. So here this is the kind of sink message. Then that particular message is transferred to the register, like the cash and the selection is transferred to the register, and once again the operation or else the activity of execution started over here. Then this checks, the dispenser checks the availability of the selection. Suppose if the can is available, then it says that the can is available, you can take the cash, like you can deposit the cash, you can update the register, and you can vend the can to the customer. So this is the thing, this is the sequence that has to be followed. Look here, in the check availability, basing upon the choice he has made, it says available, as it is the best case, or else as it is the case that that best case scenario is been tested, it is, so I am saying that this is, the can is available. And then here the updation of the register is taking place, like I have to update the register, like whatever the customer he has given the amount, that particular thing needs to be updated. And then I can say the dispenser to release the can. So the release can is done over here as an asynchronous message, and then that can is been collected by the customer. So this is the scenario, or else this is the sequence diagram for the best case scenario of the buy soda. Let us see another case wherein which the can, whatever the customer is selecting, it has been sold out. So there is no more stock in the machine available. So let us say it is the front panel is accepting the cash and the selection, and then the customer's input is been transferred to the register, and that particular register is checking the availability of the selection made by the customer. So suppose if it is sold out, then it should return back the cash. The choice you had made is not available, so I am returning you the cash. So display prompt that it is being sold out of stock. So this particular thing, this sequence diagram is depicting the model, that is sold out scenario of a buy soda use case. Then there is another scenario wherein which the incorrect change has been given. Incorrect change is given by the customer. So this needs to be keep track. So customer is giving some sort of cash and selection, and then customer input cash, like register takes the cash and the selection made by the customer, and then it is checking the availability. Suppose if the thing is like the can is available, and check for the change. There is a kind of like checking mechanism, or else if then condition is there, wherein which it is checking for the change, whether the change is available or not. And then suppose if the change is available, then it is sending the giving it to the user. Suppose if it doesn't have any change, then what it should do? Like it should return back the cash, and then it should display a message called as that the cash given by you is not insufficient, or else excess and no change is available. So this is the sequence diagram that is depicting the incorrect change scenario. Let us see the sequence diagram that models that incorrect change and machine is out of change scenario, wherein which the user is putting some sort of money, wherein which it doesn't have the change, the machine doesn't have the change to give back it to the customer. So here let us check the condition, check for change. If the scenario we are testing is the change is not available. So return back the cash and display the prompt as use correct change. So another thing is there called as the generic sequence diagram. Generic sequence diagram is nothing but, till now we have put one scenario in a sequence diagram. So use cases are nothing but they are the group of scenarios wherein which it contributes to one use case. But suppose if you want to depict all the scenarios in the same sequence diagram, it is also possible. Relevant sequence scenarios, suppose if you want to depict in the single sequence diagram, that is also is possible. Earlier we had seen a scenario by scenario. One is the best case, one is out of change, one is out of change and then out of stock. So such kind of scenario by scenario we had seen. But in this particular generic sequence diagram, it is a kind of general diagram wherein which it will test all kind of possibilities. Like suppose if there are several options, all that particular options we can mention it in the same sequence diagram. So that particular sequence diagram is called as a generic sequence diagram. So let us see whatever that we had made it earlier single by case by case, let us generalize them and put it in a single sequence diagram. Here the front panel is accepting the cash as well as the selection, and then the customer, whatever the customer selected, whatever the cash that is been given by the customer, the register is checking whether the cash is greater than price or not. So suppose if the cash is greater than the price, you should tend the change. And within the change, but that particular condition also you have to check whether the change is available in the machine or not. If the change is available, then it should release the can, as well as it should release the cash also to him. It should release the change also to him. Suppose if the customer gave the cash greater than the price and it doesn't have the cash, like change available with the machine. Then it should return back the cache itself, and it should say please put the cache exactly so that it can disperse the CAN. So this particular thing needs to be taken care. So if the cache is greater than price, check for change. Suppose if no change is there, return back the cache. That particular condition we had checked over here in the generic scenario. So suppose in the earlier case, for this particular scenario, we had designed a single sequence diagram. But for in this particular generic sequence diagram, I am checking the next condition also. If change is available, transaction over no change. So this is the thing that will be displayed along with the no change, and then display the prompt use correct change. So these particular two things will be happening. Suppose if the cache is there, it should give back the change to the customer. Look here, and then the transaction is over, selection available, receive the soda by the customer. Suppose it should also check the another condition called as the check availability, whether the can selected by the user is available with the vending machine or not. That particular thing also should be checked. So along with that particular, associated with that particular condition, there are two possibilities. One is, suppose if the can is available, like the stock is available, then it should give back the can to the user. Suppose if the can is not available with the vending machine, it should say that out of stock, you can press another selection or you can take back the cash. So these are the two possibilities that needs to be taken care. So in this particular sequence diagram, we are trying to keep all kinds of conditions to be checked against each and every object. So this is a kind of general situation or generic kind of thing, wherein which we are taking some group of scenarios and transforming it into a kind of sequence diagram. Next, there is another example. Suppose if that particular soda vending machine, I am not directly transacting it using the cash and the manual key in pressings. So suppose if that particular machine is being operated using the cell phone. So I am not touching the machine, just I am using the cell phone and I am making the transactions. So in this particular method, what is happening is, so for that reason I am trying to model this system. There are three components, as I have told you earlier, the front resistor and then the dispenser, and then there is the aggregation component over here in order to form a soda machine. But this particular soda machine, the customer is not directly interacting with the manual, with the hands or manual thing. So here this particular customer is interacting the machine with a kind of cell phone. So he is just pressing in the kind of credit card number, and then that particular credit card number is being received by the front panel using a sensor, and then by that particular message received by the front panel, it is transferring the message to the register, and register will check whether that particular transaction is approved or not from the banks, and then the automatically, if it is approved, then the soda can is being delivered to the customer. Suppose if it is not approved, then the transaction remains invalid. So in order to put this particular interface with the kind of cell phone, another kind of thing should be maintained, that is the transaction record. So that particular transaction record, there are four attributes. One is the credit card number, the date, the selection and the price. So this particular transaction record should be updated, because here we are not at all the vending machine is not at all taking the money in terms of amount, in terms of some sort of money and all. It is just taking the number from the credit card numbers, and then it is checking again as the banks. So then it is allowing the transaction to happen. So for that reason, it should maintain the transaction details in the form of a transaction record. This particular case study can be transformed into a sequence kind of diagram. Let us see. I had incorporated another thing, another object called as the cell phone object, along with the customer front and then the dispenser. So here the customer is inputting through a cell phone to the front panel the credit card number and the option, like the selection of the can, choice of the can. So both the things are being checked, and then accordingly, suppose if it is approved, the transaction is approved, it is issuing the can. Suppose if the transaction is not approved, it is saying sorry, the transaction is not allowed. So the same thing I had incorporated in this particular sequence diagram. And then here, along with the other things, it is also creating a transaction record. So that particular transaction record also I had created. So this particular transaction record is also a kind of object, needs updation from time to time. Whenever there is a customer approaching the vending machine, whenever he is using the cell phone, whenever he is using the interface via cell phone, then obviously the transaction record needs to be updated. So for that reason, so an object is once again sending some sort of messages to the another object called as the transaction record. So in this particular sequence diagram, I had created another object called as the transaction record, and then I am quite frequently I am updating that particular transaction record also. So suppose if a machine is there wherein which both the things are allowed, you can put the directly the money from the front panel, as well as if at all it is not available and if you have the wireless like the cell phone, it is the thing like wireless communication is also available, then you can make your choice using the cell phone. Then you have to transform this picture. Let us please take it as an exercise so that both the cases should be fulfilled, a cell phone case as well as the manual kind of case, and try to draw the sequence diagram, generic kind of sequence diagram, wherein which it should fulfill the condition of the manual things, manual transaction, as well as the mobile transactions. So whenever we try to create some sort of objects, we try to destruct that particular object after the transactions are over. So for that particular thing, there is a symbol called as, after the transaction record is there, suppose all the transactions are over, and then suppose if you want to destruct that particular object, you have to draw the line, the timeline, lifeline, and then you have to end that particular lifeline using the cross arrow mark. So this particular thing automatically gets destroyed. This is the kind of thing wherein which it is automatically destroyed. In the second case, yes, something is activating the thing to happen, like the destruction to be done to the transaction record. The front panel is activating an operation wherein which it destroys, this particular front panel object destroys the second object, like transaction record object. So here, this is the second case. This particular first case is automatic destruction of itself. Second case is something is activating and then something is making the second thing to destroy. So that is the destruction wherein which the second object is also participated. So with this, I hope you had understood today's topic of sequential diagram. The first case, that is the thing wherein which automatically the class diagram has been transformed into a sequence diagram. And in the second context, we had taken some sort of scenario and then we tried to change that particular scenario of the use case into the sequence diagram. Please try the exercise that we had given earlier, like the toaster exercises, the ATM exercise, and the soda machine exercise, and then the fax machine exercise. Please try to transform those kinds of exercise use cases into the sequence diagrams. With this, I conclude the session. All the best.